بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم أما بعد. In every era there was a trend that people would take on something would become vogue, something would become common, something would become a trend, a craze, a fashion, a style, the modus operandi of the time. So, in the past, what would happen is that there wasn't really any fashion. Each country, each tribe, each area, each location had their own style, had their own trend. So the Romans, the Persians, the Red Indians, each tribe with their own identity, which carried on for generations. So there was an evolution with regards to fashion. There wasn't actually something of fashion. The fashion was what they grew up in, what their system imbibed. So when this human being has limitations, the avenues of experimentation are limited and restricted, and that his vision, his desire, his ambition is also limited. For example, a person's growing up in their whole life, they're eating a simple meal, just plain rice, only plain rice, then for them that is food, that is a luxury, that is a bounty. But the person who grew up with seven course meals, then rice is a burden for them, plain rice. So likewise, with regards to fashion, with regards to everything else, so as time evolved and certain nations conquered certain places, they would take on those new trends and the country conquered would follow the original. So if the Romans conquered a certain area, then people would start wearing the clothing of the Romans because they were the superpower, they were the trendsetters. And if they found anything in that country, then they would become part and parcel of their culture and their way of life. So what would happen is actually, because they were the front runners, they were spearheading the conquest, they would become trendsetters. And whichever country was conquered, people would follow them. So, and they would take the best of what they found in their conquests. So it was always evolution on that aspect. And that was the so-called fashion of the era. There wasn't what we have now in the 21st century, where everything is a fashion. Anything is a fashion. A person is not fashionable, that's also a fashion. And a mix of anything. So in this whole mix, we've lost our identity, we've lost our culture, we've lost our lead where we should have been. So that is fashion. In the 21st century, where it is evolved, we've got manufacturing plants, we've got catwalks. So the 21st century, that's why they say 2020's fashion was really terrible, probably because nobody had any taste, probably because nobody had any taste. So we've lost the original, the asal, and the asal and the original, where we should have been with regards to following the sunnah. And fashion is not restricted to only clothing. People think of clothing, but it's a mix. So with fashion comes the food, comes the home decor, it comes with the lifestyle, the vehicle, the cars, the designs, the everything. Part of fashion is modesty. And the culture you brought up with also plays an important role. One is the inherent culture which a person grew up with. So when a person starts compromising on that, then it brings It brings other ways of life and it destroys the original completely. So this fashion in the 21st century is so powerful, then a person will choose a brand over practicality. So a bag doesn't have the convenience, it doesn't have the compartments. It's a branded product. It is another no-name brand that will suit you, that will suffice for your needs. It's got everything you got, but a person will choose brand over non-brand. Why? Because of the importance that has been highlighted of this brand. So we've become brand orientated, but brand orientated with regards to the dunyawi terms, not the ukhrawi terms, with not regards to the year after. A person wants to buy a jacket, it doesn't even have pockets, it's just a fake pocket. It's inconvenient, it's not comfortable. But because of the style and the brand, a person will opt for that. Shoes. So a person has an option of a very comfortable, a realistic, a practical shoe and a branded shoe. Then a person will choose the branded one, especially ladies. So they'll choose the brand, but when you wear it, you're just waiting to get out. You're dying to get home. Why? Because we bought it for the brand. We never bought it for the convenience. So likewise also. So when culture leaves, take for example, amongst the Indians, Kari Kichri is quite famous, common amongst them. Now when we replace it with McDonald's, we've replaced it with KFCs, then you start losing the love for that food and that becomes lost in history. So that's the first nuksan. Secondly, harm, the new food brings in a culture on its own. So having burgers, having hot dogs, standing and eating is part of it. Driving and eating is part of it. Doing work and eating is part of it. Then food needs drinks, so it draws the Coke. That Coke, that eating becomes with a culture. It needs somebody next to you. It needs somebody to eat with you. It needs other evils and sins that come with it. So that mindset that culture starts becoming part and parcel of a person. To have pride, to be arrogant, also the food starts drawing that mizaj, that mindset. It starts controlling a person and it starts governing a person's life. Why? Because they start inculcating the habits of the culture, of the mindset which they've adopted. And eventually we lose focus and we lose our identity completely. So they say there was a jogger, he went jogging, not usual jog, and after a while he was tired, he got to the park. He sat down on the bench, very exhausted. And he's seen somebody by his side, so wiping his perspiration. He's seen a young girl with what strange clothing in his impression with the boyish haircut. He was trying to identify whether she was a boy or he was a girl. So out of shock he said, "Oh my word, the fashion of these young folks of nowadays, young kids, folks, you can't even tell if it's a boy or girl. You can't even tell if it's a boy or girl." So somebody else was there, heard him say, next to that youngster, "That young folk, hey, that young folk you are talking about is my daughter. She is my daughter." There was a stranger next to this person, yeah. And he apologized and said, "I'm so sorry. I didn't know that you were her father. I didn't know that you were her father." So the person replied, "Hey," he was very angry. So he was actually a she, and she said, "I'm her mother." So everybody thought, so he was a he, but turned out to be a she. So in this era, nowadays, Zamana, we cannot even identify, we cannot even differentiate that people have lost identities completely. So we go back in history, the fashion world, the clothing started from the 16th century, and it culminated, materialized to today, where we have the advanced catwalks of New York and Paris, the fashion shows, the production line, the brands. It's evolved to the very next level. So Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam came, and there was darkness, there was bad customs, there was evil customs, there was old customs. The world was filled with darkness. His appearance brought light and removed all the darkness. It was a fashion that fashioned the life of people. It forged the destiny of humanity. It set a standard above all standards. Till Qiyamah, this would be the biggest revolution the earth had ever seen. The greatest fashion in the history of humanity. A system, a way of life that was perfect. So Deen came, it abrogated every other order. It was a culture of all cultures. It abrogated all other religions. It commanded every cult. It was a trend of trends. It brought order in all the disorder. It fused all the confusion. It united all the disunity. It brought peace and tranquility from all the pandemonium, all the turbulence. This was a climax, this was a highlight, this was a culmination of the end of the chain of Anbiya alayhimus salatu wassalam. And normally they say, save the best for last. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, save the best, Nabi alayhi salatu wassalam, for the last. And he brought something which the world was searching for and will search for till Qiyamah. So we have to be very cautious and see, are we getting influenced and getting affected by these cultures, by these fashions, by these so-called trends? And is our focus more akhirat, the trend of Nubuwa? The mashayikh, when they used to make dua, they used to say, ya mumsik as-sama an taka'a al-ard amsik ad-dunya anni. Oh, the one who controls the heavens and prevents it from falling on earth, prevent the world from us, deprive us of dunya. All this dunya that we are seeing, please deprive us of it. They were making that dua. Why should Allah prevent them from all these benefits? Because if dunya came to them, they weren't sure if they will have the capacity and the potential to pass that imtihan and test. So rather, ya Allah, you keep it, we rather don't go to the test, we'll make sabr on all the difficulties. Secondly is, ya Allah, if you deprive us of dunya, then we will be bestowed with akhirat. So dunya was not the ultimate plan, dunya was not the ultimate priority in place, because dunya is limited. And the real fashion, the real trend was in Jannah, the real clothing was in Jannah, the real life here was the life of akhirat. So a person needs to introspect and see, is deen my priority or dunya my priority? And have I got caught by these brands? Is the brand great? Is the Gucci's and the Armani's and the Louis Vuitton's and the Prada's of this world, when we pass it, does it make our heart tick? Does it give us a thrill when we wear it? Or when we don on the sunnah garment, that's for men and lady as well, do we feel pride that Allah is happy with me? Allah is looking at me with mercy. I don't mind dying in this condition and be resurrected on the day of Qiyamah. So which brand do we attach ourselves to? Muhammad ibn Muntakadir used to say, أَرَأَيْتَ أَنَّ رَجُلًا صَوْمَ الدَّهْرِ لَا يُفْتِرُ وَقَامَ اللَّيْلِ لَا يَفْتُرُ. That if a person has to fast forever, he does not ever break his momentum for fasting, and he stays awake the entire night. وَتَصَدَّقَ بِمَالِهِ, he gives sadaqah for all his wealth. وَجَاهَدَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ, and he strives in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَاجْتَنَبَ مَحَارِمَ اللَّهِ, and he abstains from all the gunas and sins, غَيْرَ أَنَّهُ يُؤْتَى بِهِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ فَيُقَالُ, on the day of Qiyamah it will be told to him, أَمَا أَنَّ هَذَا عَظَّمَ فِي أَيْنِهِ مَا صَغْرَ اللَّهِ, that which Allah considered insignificant, you considered it great and magnificent. وَصَغْرَ فِي أَيْنِهِ مَا عَظَّمَهُ اللَّهِ, and what Allah considered great, you considered on insignificant. Allah considered Quran great, Allah considered the Sunnah great, Allah considered the Miswak great, you considered the toothbrush greater. Allah considered the tilawat of Quran great, you considered reading magazines and posts and social media. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala considered the clothing of Nabi alayhi salam great, you considered the clothing of Batil, the brand of Batil great. So even if a person did all of this, he was saying, كَيْفَ تَرَى يَكُونُ حَالُهُ, what you think so will be his condition. فَمَمْ مِنَّا لَيْسَ هَكَذَا, who of us are not part of this part and parcel of this crime? Allah has thought something to be great, we thought so it to be insignificant, and vice versa. الدُّنْيَا عَذِيمَةٌ عِنْدَمَا مَا اِكْتَرَفْنَا مِنَ الذُّنُوبِ الْخَطَايَا, that no matter how much we say, oh ya Allah, I'm gunagar, I'm a sinner, we make tawbah, the bottom line is that we still love dunya, and dunya is great in our eyes. So we have to remember, this world is world about extortion, it's about taking benefit from us. So every fashion, we just an experiment, what advertisements, which brand can get the best brand out and make us slaves to these brands. Because it's all about extracting the most out of humanity. So we shouldn't get caught in these traps. A man went to see a psychiatrist and he confessed. He said, I've got a problem. What's your problem? Suicidal tendencies. I've got this urge to kill myself. And it just happened spontaneously. I don't know when, how, what, etc. So the psychiatrist thought about it and said, I think so in these circumstances, can you pay in advance for a few sessions? So even a psychiatrist, a psychologist, who's supposed to be there for our benefit, is looking for their own benefit. So like that, whether it's fashion, whether it's the medical industry, wherever it is, depending, illa mashallah, but we should be very cautious. People go into debt because of this trend, because of the brand, the bag, the features. People don't give preference to features compared to necessity and need. We give preference to the brands, the propaganda. So the whole world will come with solutions, but all these solutions will fail. These systems will crash. It's all about extortion, so that you can continue paying till your last, as much as can be extracted. Speaking about the psychiatrist, somebody went to a psychiatrist. He had a serious problem, 6 months, 1 year, 2 years, 3 years. He had a fear that there were monsters lurking under his bed. So after much effort from the psychiatrist, it was all in vain. And the man came nowhere near close to being cured. So he even decided that I'm going to waste my money now. 3 years has passed. So it happened that the psychiatrist bumped into him somewhere. And he looked very happy, thrilled. So he said, hey, you're looking very well. The man said, yes. And I've been cured. So after all this time, I can finally go to sleep at night peacefully, not to worry about the monsters lurking in my bed. So the psychiatrist was shocked and puzzled. How did you manage to get cured? Everything I tried didn't work. So he said, I went to see a different doctor. He's a behaviorist. And he cured me in one session. Psychiatrist in one session. How is it possible? He said, it was simple. He told me to saw the legs off my bed. He told me to saw the legs off my bed. So solutions are simple, but you know, to extort money from somebody, then in the name of finding solutions, we don't find solutions. Speaking about psychiatrists, they say the hotline message in the psychiatrist system is, if you are obsessive compulsive, press 1 repeatedly. If you are codependent, please ask someone to press 2. If you have multiple personality disorder, press 3, 4, 5 and 6. If you are schizophrenic, please listen carefully. A little voice will tell you which number to press. If you are paranoid and delusional, we know who you are and what you want. Just stay on the line till we trace the call. And if you are a manic depressive, it doesn't matter which number you press, no one will answer. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the reality of making amal. The amal for today was to engage in deen, the knowledge of deen, etc. Be to sulul arham. Through it, ties of kingship are cemented. وَبِهِ عُرَفُ الْحَلَالِ مِنَ الْحَرَامِ. A person will differentiate and identify lawful from prohibited. وَهُ إِمَامُ الْعَمَلُ وَالْعَمَلُ تَابِعُهُ. It is the imam of all amal, and amal follows it. يُلْهَمُهُ السُّعَدَاءُ. The fortunate are inspired. وَيُحْرَمُهُ الْأَشْقِيَاءُ. And the unfortunate are deprived. وَآخِرُ دَعْوَانَا الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ.